Captain Bly is having a very bad day.
Dang it!
I have to admit, I feel a little guilty for contributing to it. We just witnessed the lowest ebb of his personal and professional life played out for entertainment. There have been four versions of Captain Bly's sudden career demotion depicted on film since 1933. So there's something compelling which causes filmmakers to revisit this hoary maritime event. Aside from the bounty, there have been a bunch of other mutinies portrayed on film since the silent era. It was easy to make sense of what's happening here. Bad guys get their just desserts. Your early renditions of Captain William Bly are uncomplicated.
Discipline's the thing. A seaman's a seaman, a captain's a captain, and a midshipman, Sir Joseph or no Sir Joseph, is the lowest form of animal life in the British Navy.
Naturally, as the 20th century proceeded, the picture gets muddier as morality goes from black and white to shades of gray.
Make love to that damn daughter of his.
Every mutiny story offers two sides, and the filmmakers make their bent clear. But what do you, the viewer, see? Can you understand the point of view of the deposed skipper?
Damn you, man. Don't you bloody cross me.
It's worth looking at the first major mutiny in film, Sergei Eisenstein's Battleship Potemkin, to identify some early trends. This movie is revered for any number of reasons, such as its mix of pioneering montage and continuity editing techniques. It's pure red commie propaganda, but perhaps the finest red commie propaganda of all time. Every image was designed to deify the revolution and the sailors who pushed back against the Tsarist admiralty. The officers foist rotten meat on those poor sailors, one of the countless indignities suffered by the proletariat. The ship's doctor says it's perfectly healthy, and the captain offers to hear anyone who chooses to further complain. Those who step forward are immediately condemned to be shot. And this is where the flashpoint of the mutiny starts. Eisenstein says mutiny is necessary. Mutiny is righteous! The Red Uprising was born of this heroic maritime betrayal, and all who died in the insurrection were martyrs. Our judgment of the officers is clear.
It's time for you to walk the plank!
Soon after, the Anglo world begins its film fascination with the bounty, first in 1933 with In the Wake of the Bounty, and shortly thereafter in 1935 with the more famous Mutiny on the Bounty. These iterations, along with the 62 remake, were all based on the same novel, Mutiny on the Bounty by Charles Nordhoff and James Norman Hall. The 1933 version is an Aussie production featuring Errol Flynn as Fletcher Christian and some guy named Maine Linton as Bly.
Now take these orders, Mr. Christian, and see that they are carried out.
The first Hollywood version features marquee idol Clark Gable as Christian and pug-faced Charles Lawton as the captain.
I like having a gentleman as my subordinate.
Being a self-made man, I admire you for that, sir.
And for very little else?
The Lewis Milestone-directed 1962 version famously boasts Marlon Brando as Christian, and Trevor Howard as the skipper.
I understand we're taking this river scow halfway round the world on a grocer's errand.
I take a somewhat different view.
Are you seeing what I'm seeing? If you're stacking the deck with pretty faces Flynn, Gable, and Brando as your first mate, you're not really trying to get us to sympathize with the captain, are you? Also, from here on out, I'm going to omit the 1933 version because it's technically not a drama, but rather a 60-minute travelogue with stage scenes at the front. At its essence, Gable's version of Fletcher Christian is not too far from where Brando would go with it almost 30 years later. He's a principled sailor disgusted by the cruel treatment of his underlings and smitten by new Tahitian love.
Ship's company will bear witness that I sign in obedience to your orders.
Simple enough concepts, which they come at from two different ways. Gable went rugged and masculine with it, and Brando chose a more effete and upper-class depiction. On the surface, it's hard to argue with their choices to roust William Bly out of bed and take his ship away. But who speaks for Bly? Certainly these depictions are far from innocent, but what does he have to say for himself?
The best of my recollection, Mr. Christian, you're usually partial to cheese.
Now, for the sake of discussion, the real-life mission of the Bounty was to spend 2 years at sea sailing from Portsmouth, England to Tahiti, and then on to Jamaica, exploiting breadfruit tree cuttings from one tropic to the other in order to provide a cheap food source for Caribbean slaves. Hey, this is a terrible motivation, but this is a terrible time in history. Lawton's captain is a brutally cruel and inhumane man who feels like he's doing the best he can with the waste press-ganged into serving aboard his ship.
You mutinous dog.
Retract that, sir.
I will repeat it, you're a mutinous dog.
He's a lieutenant in King George's Navy, and he knows only blind obedience to the crown. Duty is what compels him, a reward unto itself.
Mr. Christian,
Look at you, disgrace to the Navy.
Charlie Lawton does a wonderful job of being a son of a bitch whilst showing his vulnerability to the audience. So we're always aware there's a man inside that monster. But doubtless he's a bad man, and we know how to deal with those on this ship.
Computer, remove the plague!
Trevor Howard has a different motivation, speed and efficiency. This Bly reads more like a deranged CEO, maximizing his time spent on the open ocean with the yield of the voyage.
The Articles of War provide most adequately for a man who calls his captain a thief.
Nothing could withstand his battering ram determination to cut corners in order to reach the market faster.
My point is that cruelty with purpose is not cruelty. It's efficiency.
Howard's captain is a man who doesn't have the connections to aristocracy his first mate does, so he has to go to work the old-fashioned way.
I will tolerate nothing less than a man's best efforts, officer or seaman. Highborn connections are no substitute for hard work.
His cruelty is abhorrent, so we have no choice but to give him the business. 22 years later, director Roger Donaldson's take on the story, The Bounty, wasn't a remake of the earlier films, but a transmogrified version of an aborted David Lean project, which foundered on matters of budget. It was also a box office bomb in 1984, but come on, it's fantastic. And it's loaded with a red meat array of actors, like Anthony Hopkins as Bly and Mel Gibson as Christian, bolstered by supporting performances by Laurence Olivier, Liam Neeson, Bernard Hill, Phil Davis, and a baby-faced Daniel Day-Lewis.
Must I suffer this before the...
You will suffer my correction whenever you're at fault, sir.
What fault?
God damn your eyes, man! You turned your back on me!
Of all the bounties, this one is the most psychological, as befitting the epoch in which it was created. The Tony Hopkins conception of Bly is ambitious like Trevor Howard, but not nearly as cruel as Charlie Lawton's. But he has shades of being overwhelmed, describing a man who might be making it up as he goes along. Hey, at least he has his old friend Fletcher Christian to get his back, right?
Fletcher, I want you to sail with me again.
In what capacity?
I want you to be master's mate, if you agree, that is.
The mutiny, which is only triggered by a foolish decision...
We shall go with the winds to Jamaica by way of Cape Horn.
...is all the more painful because it comes at the hands of a man Bly trusted, someone who bounced his daughters on his knee. The heartbreak is real.
Think of my family and my friendship! Think of my wife!
I am in hell!
Hopkins' character of Bly is flawed, tempestuous, and even tender, which is why it's fathoms beyond his earlier counterparts.
Ho ho! Not too much! Ho ho ho!
I want to zigzag away from The Bounty to 1954's Kane Mutiny and Captain Philip Francis Queeg. There are some jingoist aspects to this movie, which gently call back Eisenstein's techniques and lionize in the armed services, especially in the wake of World War II just 9 years earlier. However, Humphrey Bogart gives a tour de force performance, undercutting his vast array of gruff men. His captain is damaged and unsteady, rocked by his experiences in combat.
I've had 7 tough years in the Atlantic, and believe you me, they made the last 2 mighty interesting. The way those subs ganged up on us, I thought they had it in for me personally.
While Queeg's lack of fitness plays out, senior officers Robert Francis, Fred McMurray, and Van Johnson plot to undermine the captain for the benefit of the ship and its crew.
Has the thought ever occurred to you that our captain might be unbalanced?
Oh, cut the jokes.
I'm no psychiatrist, but I know something about abnormal behavior.
The Kane Mutiny features something no other seaborne betrayal can boast, which is a suggested rapprochement with the captain.
If there was only some way we could help each other. If there's anything any of you would like to say, I'll be glad to listen.
During a climactic scene in a high storm, the executive officers have no choice but to relieve Queeg of his command in order to save the ship, Shades of the Bounty.
I'm sorry, sir, but you're not issuing orders on this bridge anymore. I've relieved you.
But it's hard to feel good about the mutiny, if only because of Queeg's broken spirit.
Not bad for a creature with no vertebrae.
Thus, the leitmotif of the latter half of the 20th century has been to show some clear and present danger triggering the mutiny. And a recent example is Tony Scott's 1995 submarine thriller, Crimson Tide.
We constitute the front line and the last line of defense.
It's a metal techno thriller, as was Scott's metier, but it allows enough room for his leading men, Denzel Washington and Gene Hackman, to play out a contest of wills in totally believable fashion.
In my humble opinion, in the nuclear world, the true enemy is war itself.
Nuclear annihilation is the name of this game. If the USS Alabama makes a mistake, it could start World War III. The craft receives cryptic missile orders just before the radio room is damaged, and Captain Hackman interprets it differently from Executive Officer Washington. Hackman sets a course to Russia for launch, while Washington wants to repair the radio for clarification.
We have rules that are not open to interpretation, personal intuition, gut feelings, hairs on the back of your neck.
The mutiny comes for the best reason of all, to save civilization. Hackman's captain is a blood and guts Navy man, rigidly dogmatic about the chain of command.
I've made a decision. I'm captain of this boat. Now shut the fuck up!
There's no other road past the captain other than the hard way. So the principled officer Denzel makes the difficult decision to go down it.
Captain, I relieve you of your command of this ship.
Of course, Washington is proven correct in the end, and Hackman is nonplussed at how he got it so wrong. At his inquest, the captain insists on early retirement, and is even able to admit he was wrong in the face of losing face.
Just want to say thank you. You were right and I was wrong.
This captain has something which his forebears did not. Humility.
Ah, Squiddy. I got nothing against ya.
Oh, the canvas can do miracles. Just you wait and see. Believe me. Sailing takes me away to where I've always heard it could be. Just a dream and the wind to carry me. Soon I will be free. Lieutenant William Bligh was a simple man. All he asked for was a tall ship and a star to sail her by. The wheels kick and the wind song and the white sail shaking. Actually, that's a lot of bullshit. What Bligh really wanted was to brutally run a crew of men with the aim of transplanting a foodstuff from one rustic backwater to another, with the aim of keeping down the aggregate cost of human chattel slavery. There's little good which can come of any of this.
Minister the punishment now.
But if we were to put on his tricorn cap and try to figure out what he was thinking in the run-up to his sudden removal from the quarterdeck of the Bounty in 1787, what would we believe? A betrayal from a good friend? A source of treachery never considered? The impudence of renegades, brigands, and blackguards overstepping their remit? Or perhaps the unthinkable? The very embargoing of your command in the service of King George?
I hate the sea and everything in it.
If you're hard on those swine, it's because bigger things are afoot than comfort. There's the supremacy of British sea power, the stingy rations, the brutal discipline, the casual disregard for safety. These things are all in the service of something far greater than any single vessel. There's glory and boldness to maintain, the hallmarks of English maritime tradition.
Mr. Fryer, and this man will be keel-hauled.
I mean, you would have to buy a shit ton of nonsense to accept that line of thinking. A mutinied captain has always made terrible moves to ensure his men rise up against him.
Justice and decency are carried in the heart of the captain, or they be not aboard.
Why? Queeg, Ramsey. These are flawed humans who unquestionably get what they deserve. The fun is watching the interpretation of monstrous behavior in the hands of skilled performers, and to measure a role against the many actors who get the chance to essay it.
Oh, Anthony Hopkins, yeah.
I do a very good Anthony Hopkins.
Well, I think I do an even better Anthony Hopkins.
Come back here, Mr. Fryer, get down your eyes. You turned your back on me, man.
That's good.
The finest in men's neckwear since 1982.